Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. Today I'm continuing my conversations with Brother Jason Jack, and we're working on our series, 101 Verses Proving Faith Alone. And on our list of 100, we today are on number 62. So if you have not seen all the previous videos on this subject, I hope you will go back to my YouTube channel, Sin City Preacher, and watch this series from the beginning. Brother, you all set to go?
I'm ready.
Okay, so 62 on our list is 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 through 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Hey, brother, what say you?
All right, so this is one or two of Peter's letters, and he starts off strong in 1 Peter 1. Interesting, right off the bat, how we receive salvation is by the abundant mercy of God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's how we overcome death. And we do that not by our own power, the power of man, you know, the will of man, the will of the flesh, but it's of God. It's the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And, you know, so just talked about basically verses 3 and 5, and then right in the middle of that, what is this lively hope that he's talking about? Reminds us of the blessed hope in Titus that, when Paul's writing to Titus in Titus 2:13, the blessed hope, same thing. We have a lively hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ because he overcame death. And we know this for a fact that he rose from the dead 3 days later. And we become heirs and joint heirs with him. And that is an inheritance. We have inheritance like a son. Our daughter has an inheritance of their parent. We have an incorruptible, undefiled inheritance reserved in heaven by our Father, our Heavenly Father.
Well, brother, I think you've gotten to know me quite well over the last few months, and you probably just you realize why I always go back to this point about the fact that this gospel message, the good news that we're saved by grace alone through faith alone in Christ alone, it's the same message of salvation we find throughout the whole Bible. It's the same message that was preached by Jesus, John, Peter, and Paul. There is no difference in what Paul preached for salvation and the others. It's one gospel. There's no two separate gospels like the gospel of the grace of God versus the gospel of the kingdom of God. The kingdom is also a salvation message. It's the same thing. And here, and the reason I'm emphasizing that is because this is 1 Peter, written by Peter. And not only here in this epistle, but if you go to my playlist, verse by verse commentary on the book of Acts, every time Peter is making a public preaching, a sermon, you can see that his message is the same as Paul's. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, the payment for our sins, the free gift, all of that is the content of Peter's sermons. And we find all that right here in these verses here. So I think that's, I can't say that too much. And it's, I know that, brother, you might think that I'm, you know, kind of overdoing this subject, but because the group of people who teach that you can only be saved by the words of Paul, it's a tiny minority, but they're a pretty powerful minority. They're very vocal. They're very adamant. They're very skillful at their argument. And I hate to see people get sucked into to believing that you can't get saved by listening to the words of Jesus, and you can't get saved by reading the Gospel of John. So that it's my one of my biggest pet peeves. So I'm going to go into the content of the verse a little bit more here, but I don't want to go on too long without getting a chance to reply. So give me your thoughts, and then I'll look more at these verses.
Yeah, I mean, the purpose of the book of John was so that we would believe on the Son of God and have everlasting life through his name. You can certainly, John 3:15 is the salvation verse, John 6:47 and John 5:24, they're all salvation verses. You hear the gospel, you hear the good news of Jesus Christ through those verses, and can certainly be saved. It's not just exclusive to the epistle that Paul wrote. Just like you mentioned, we see the same gospel message in 1 Peter 1 right now.
Yes, so here we have Peter not talking about a earthly kingdom that Jesus is going to set up. In other words, the gospel that, hey, the Messiah is going to set up his kingdom. He's going to be king of the Jews and set up an earthly kingdom. No, he's talking about, in the subject of this, is our bodily resurrection and eternal life. And so, again, the first key word here is, you pointed out, it's mercy. It's because God is merciful. It's not because we earned it and God owes us salvation because of our, you know, the way, how well we behaved and followed the commandments. It's because he's merciful. And, another word that is, you know, kind of, I think it's kind of confused with mercy. It's not really the same thing, and it's grace. To me, they're actually the opposite points. Mercy is if you deserve something bad, some kind of punishment, and I spare you, then I'm showing you mercy. But if you don't deserve something really good, and yet I give it to you, because you haven't even earned it or deserved it or anything, but just out of the goodness of my heart, I'm being gracious and I'm giving it to you. That's grace. So grace is receiving something good that we didn't earn, didn't deserve, and mercy is being spared something bad that we do deserve. So in that way, they're kind of opposite. But you know, I'm thankful for the mercy and the grace of God. So it says, to his abundant mercy. Now, he says, hath begotten us. Begotten, brother, let me ask you, tell me what you think begotten means in this verse.
Well, not only does it say begotten us, but begotten us again. And, you know, I look at it sort of like, you know, we are born of the flesh. You know, we're earthy, as it says in 1 Corinthians 15, which this passage kind of reminds me of, speaking of the incorruptible, speaking of the resurrection, the spiritual body that we'll receive as a believer in Jesus Christ. But there's also the spiritual rebirth and being begotten of God, becoming a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And so that's what this is talking about, that second, you know, that rebirth. That we have that spiritual birth that we have through faith, by God's grace, by his mercy, but through faith in Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here we have the Apostle Peter talking about us being begotten And that is just another way of saying born again. We are spiritually born again, just as Jesus explained in this conversation with Nicodemus. And so because God is merciful, we can be born again, begotten, unto a lively hope. Now, I really like that. I guess it's an adjective, a lively hope. It's not just a hope, but a lively hope. So I'm getting the feeling Peter is like saying, oh, aren't we really excited about this? This is thrilling. I'm really, really this hope of in the future that of the resurrection. But I don't look at the word hope in all these uses of it about salvation and the resurrection and the glorified bodies and all that. I don't look at hope as we got our fingers crossed hoping we get it. It's I look at it as the promise that we're expecting it. So we're excited about this promised resurrection. It's by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So again, unto a lively hope, I think is referring to our resurrection, but it, when it says by the resurrection of Jesus, is because by his resurrection, by his death, burial, and resurrection, this is all possible. Now, to an inheritance incorruptible. Incorruptible means that we're not going to worry about our bodies growing old and sick and diseased and falling apart and dying again. It's incorruptible and undefiled, meaning that it'll never have sin attached to it again. That fadeth not away, so we don't need to worry about somehow we could our glorified bodies and our salvation somehow will fade away and it's no longer applied. It's permanent. It's irrevocable. It's irreversible. And it's reserved in heaven for you, brother. That should certainly give you lively hope. And then finally, verse 5 says, you who are kept by the power of God. So that's our promise that eternal security. Who are kept by the power of God. So we don't have to worry about us keeping up our end of a deal or something. And if we somehow fail in our living a good life, that we lose it. No, we're kept by the power of God, not by anything we do. Through faith, that's our faith in him, unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Now, I'm not sure ready to be revealed in the last time. I'm not sure what to think of that exactly. So maybe you can enlighten me on that.
Yeah, I like how, first of all, in verse 3, just going through this verse again, in verse 3, I like how you define the word hope. You know, it's not that we're just sort of hoping, wishing, you know, maybe it's going to happen, but we're expecting it to happen. We're counting on it. It's a feeling of trust. Not a feeling of possibility that it's possibly going to happen, but we're counting on it, and we trust that it will happen, because we know that God's promise can never be broken. And so it goes on to verse 4, and as you mentioned, our inheritance is incorruptible, undefiled. It doesn't fade away, and it's reserved in heaven. And, you know, like I mentioned, this reminds me of 1 Corinthians 15, where it talks about the dead shall be raised incorruptible. You know, Peter going on later in this chapter at the end says that we are being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth in the body forever. And as I was trying to quote earlier, discussing that, 1 John 1:12, let me pull it up, because that also reminds me of what Peter is relating here, where in John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 12, but as many as received him, to them gave you power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of the man, nor the will of man, but of God. So in the same sense, in verse 5 of 1 Peter 1, we're kept by the power of God. We're not keeping ourselves saved. The power of God keeps ourselves saved. Like you said, this is a good eternal security verse, because we know that it's not by our will or things that we do in the flesh, but it's by our faith in Jesus Christ and true salvation, and ready to be revealed in the last time. I think, again, you know, just continuing to go back and see the parallels between 1 Corinthians 15, you know, it just shows the eternal nature of God and Him seeing the end from the beginning. We have been saved when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, but we have not yet received that incorruptible body. That will come at the last time, and I believe that's talked about the second coming of Jesus Christ, where the last trump, you know, in a moment, the twinkle of eye, the last trump, the trumpet shall sound, the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And so I think that last time there is speaking of that second coming of Jesus Christ, when believers in Him will be raised. There will be a resurrection of the dead, and they, believers from all time, will receive that incorruptible, undefiled spiritual body. And those that are still alive will be changed from a corruptible body to an incorruptible body.
Okay, very well done. There's a brother, Brother Joseph, he's no longer have a Christian YouTube channel, but he did a lot of work with me in the past, and but he coins, is very good at coining a term, or kind of like very clever with the language, and so he identified me as a KJV firstist. That's where that term came from. I liked how he phrased it. And so I've said this many times, but someone asked me recently in a comment about am I KJV onlyist, and if he wanted to know because of my position on eternal torment, and I said I've only talked about my viewpoint on the translations, you know, 100 times now, but just in case anybody doesn't know this, as a KJV firstist, I read the KJV first and I count on it for the truth. I would call it the Word of God. It's the Scripture. Now, I'm going to look now at the Amplified translation. So that makes me not a KJV onlyist. I'm willing to look at another translation if I think it might be helpful. Plus, if nothing else, we can compare, and if there's fault to find in a modern translation, we can point out the faults. And you've done a good job of that. You've targeted the NLT recently, and you've exposed that. Very bad in many ways, so I would refer everybody to your channel to watch your videos on the New Living Translation. But this time, I like to look at the Amplified because it's almost like a commentary translation blend, where like what we're doing right now is we're amplifying on the verse. We're adding in our thoughts. Your words are not Scripture, brother. My words aren't Scripture, but we're commenting on the Scriptures that we read and giving our thoughts and our interpretations of it, and the Amplified translation kind of does that. So I'm going to read that. I read ahead to see if it was going to be good, and I think in this case it'll be pretty helpful, pretty good. It says, "Blessed, that is, gratefully praised and adored, be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to His abundant and boundless mercy, has caused us to be born again, that is, to be reborn from above, spiritually transformed, renewed, and set apart for his purpose, to an ever-living hope and confident assurance through the, see how they're talking about that hope as a confident assurance. So that's how they're kind of defining that, the word hope there, which is, I think is very good. Confident assurance through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Beginning of verse 4 says, born anew into an inheritance which is imperishable, beyond the reach of change, and undefiled and unfading, reserved in heaven for you, who are being protected and shielded by the power of God through your faith for salvation that is ready to be revealed for you in the last time. It wasn't very helpful to me really on that last verse in that, the question I asked about what does it mean to be revealed in the last time. It didn't really elaborate on that point very much. But in all other cases, I thought that the way they amplified it was quite good. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think that was a good job of going through that verse and, like you said, expounding on it, you know, positively in the right way. And, you know, our positions are, I don't think they're really different as far as being, you know, KJV only versus KJV versus. I would still say I'm a KJV only, but I don't mind looking at other translations. But when I come to in-depth study, I turn to the KJV only because it is the inerrant Word of God, and I read the ESV and I read the NIV, and I've gone through the NLT recently, and you see the errors, and not only errors, but corruptions and perversions, mm-hmm. changing doctrine, including changing doctrine on salvation. And that's what these modern translations do. Now, with that said, I believe a few years ago when I didn't know any better and I was getting back into reading the Bible again, and the first Bible I picked up just because I had it nearby was the English Standard Version and a study Bible at that probably had as many words that weren't part of the scripture as, I mean, it was a big study Bible, and I read every word of it. And, you know, I can honestly say, you know, if I wasn't saved before, because, you know, it had been a while before I had picked up the Word of God, and it's been so long. If I was saved in the past, I had no assurance. And coming from a church that was preaching a false gospel, I knew it was a false gospel. But like I said in the past, that doesn't mean that I found the true gospel and acknowledged it and received it. So, you know, it was highly likely just a few years ago, I was lost as lost could be. But I picked up that Bible and I trusted it and I believed in God's word. And I believe I was saved by reading the English Standard Version, by reading those words and those words on salvation, that Jesus died for our sins according to scripture, was buried and rose again the third day, and that he died for me and overcame death for me, he's my savior. Those words found in the ESV, you can find that in the NIV. You can find that in the other modern translations. But if you continue to read that, those other translations, it will get you confused on doctrine, and it will begin to, when other false prophets use it and twist it, and you start listening to them, then your faith will become shipwrecked, and that assurance and confidence that you have will turn into confusion and doubt. So that's why I think you just, and ultimately I went to the King James Bible after all that was been done and read that, the King James Bible, cover to cover, you know, probably 3 or 4 times, and then when it ends, different chapters and just different studies several times since then. So I feel I'm becoming, and, you know, I don't think I'm there yet, but becoming very grounded and settled in the Word of God, I wouldn't have begun this, I wouldn't have written that book, I wouldn't have begun a YouTube channel if I didn't feel confident, because that was, I wanted to make sure that what I was teaching, what I was telling others, either in print form or in video, was the truth and was coming from the Word of God. So, I'm a KJV only, but in the same sense, you could say I'm a person because I've looked at other translations and now I'm comparing to point out errors. But, like you said, I appreciate the amplified version when it can further clarify the Word of God. And I certainly, you know, when we use the Amplified Bible in these videos, I don't mind it at all. I think most of the time, or all the time, it does one of two things. Usually, it expounds on it, clarifies it even further, gives you further assurance. A couple of times, as we've seen, it can muddy things a little bit. But if you are grounded and settled on the KJV and know what it says, and know the Word of God, then you can easily see that and just sort of red flag it, just make a mental note of it. Mm-hmm. So I like that we're bringing that in just to make those points in these video series.
I don't think I would ever recommend anybody to just take an Amplified Bible by itself, or an NIV or any other translation by itself. I recommend what we're doing right now. This is what I have, is this Bible Gateway. This is Bible Gateway. I also have a program called Bible Hub, but they're the same thing basically. But they allow you to basically put side by side and compare any translation. There must be 100 different choices on your list there. And so you can look at them side by side. So that's the only way I'm going to look at it. I'm going to look at it side by side and comparing it against the KJV. But I would say that, brother, you know, I could, at the risk of sounding like a flatterer, because I don't want anybody to think that I'm guilty of flattery, where it's okay to say kind things about someone if you're sincere and you're not trying to have some ulterior motive for your words. But I could say a lot of nice things about you, but one of the things on that list is that at least you're not like the dogmatist on KJV only, where there are actually some KJV onlyists. If we were talking and I even referenced the Amplified or any others, conversation's over. What are you, a child of the devil? You know, that's their reaction. And it's that kind of dogmatism, whether it's on Bible translations or, you know, a wide range of theological subject matter, when you disagree and you can't even talk anymore because of it, that's probably like my second complaint in Christianity, the biggest as far as the false. But I would say that, if even the strictest KJV onlys, if you and I did a video and we said we're going to compare the Amplified translation to the KJV and point out any mistakes in it, we'd get a pat on the back, you know, if that was supposed to be the purpose of it. And in that way, that's what I'm doing here. We're actually comparing them. And when it's good, we say, hey, that was helpful. If it's bad, we expose it. So if some KJV only is, rather than wanting to hate me for this, maybe they could think of it in that way. That, look, we're doing a comparison and we're going to expose the errors in the Amplified whenever we find it.
Yeah, and, you know, knowing that the KJV is the preserved Word of God, I still don't mind at all other people reading out of other translations and using it from time to study, always in comparison with the KJV, though. But what I have a problem with is revelation that they really like, and they just refuse to even open it up or listen to you and say, it's archaic, I can't read it, I don't understand it, then that's where I have a problem. Because those Christians, although they, if they believe in the true gospel of Jesus Christ, that they can get from whatever modern translation that they're reading, they're not going to, I just know because I've done it. I did it that way. I started with other translations. They're not going to mature and grow spiritually to be that disciple, ultimately, that God wants them to be, in my opinion. And the first reason I don't think that they can is because of a little bit of prideful heart. You know, I'm saying that I believe the KJV is the preserved word of God, but I'm saying read your other translation, but just put it next to it, and then work it in your daily Bible study over a year, over 2 years, over 3 years. Just hear the King James, look at it, compare it to what you're reading. Because I want that person to spiritually grow and mature. But if you have a heart of pride and say, well, I'm going to reject what you say in the KJV Bible, I don't want to read it, I'll never read it, I don't understand it, I'm just going to stick to this, then I don't think that person being very fair to themselves or the presenter who's trying to diligently get them to open up the King James Bible. Because they know that it has power, whereas some of these modern translations lose a little bit of power, you know? The KJV is like a, you know, like a coarse bat. Yeah. And some of these modern translations, people are going up to play with a crack bat. They need another bat, you know, to get that pitch hit. They may be dribbling something down the first base line and getting on base. But if you want to be, you know, an all-star, then you're going to need the KJV, in my opinion.
That's a good analogy. I was years ago in my work, and I was on a break, and I was reading a Bible commentary, and one of my Christian friends from work, this guy actually would come to my home Bible study, and he saw me reading a commentary, and he was very hard on me, criticized me, and rebuked me for, you know, you should only read the Bible itself. Don't read anything else written by men. And, you know, that's how extreme the viewpoint can be sometimes. But I asked him, I said, okay, this commentary is written by this particular person, a theologian. I don't even remember who did it, but... let's say that a famous theologian writes a commentary and you're reading it. Now, what if that theologian had not written the commentary, but was just sitting around our kitchen table with us at our Bible study and sitting there and making comments? Are we allowed to listen to his viewpoint if it's verbal? But if he puts it in writing in a book, we're not allowed to consider it? You know, so I look at looking at any translation or any commentary. Looking at the translations is basically the same. I consider it the same thing as looking at a commentary. It's another translator's opinion about how it should be expressed. It's just I look at it no different. Whoever the committee of people, I don't know who they are. I've never looked into it, but whoever the group is that came up with the language for the Amplified, it's like they're sitting with us right now, and they're expanding and amplifying their thoughts on the KJV along with us. Okay. All right. Are you anything else before we really got sidetracked? But I think that was an important point to discuss.
Yeah, we can go to the next verse.
Okay, the next one is Revelation 1, verse 5, and it says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood.
Well, I think the reason this is here to show who Jesus Christ is. He's the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He rose from the dead, overcame death for us because he loved us. That, you know, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. That reminds me of 1 John 4:14 that says, you know, that we love God because he first loved us, and then it's time to be a propitiation for our sins. And then I just looking at the way this list is shaken out, it looks like I think another reason they put this here is thinking about the blood of Jesus Christ, the redemption through his blood. Because there's just a few verses that we covered. I think it was the last verse we covered on the last video, Ephesians 1:7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So we see that same concept of the blood of Christ being the what redeems us and washes us from our sins. Getting back to the modern translation, if I read Ephesians 1:7 in the English Standard Version, through his blood would not be there. It would just be in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, and they leave out through his blood a lot. And that's why some of these you know, worship salvation teachers that go on to teach that the blood is not necessary. The reason that they do that is because they're using modern Bible translations that leave it out. So they don't have to switch verses. The modern translations have already done that for them by omitting things, especially important things like that, the blood of Jesus Christ. But we typically don't go to the book of Revelation for salvation verses, but this is certainly showing Jesus Christ overcoming death through his resurrection because of his love for us, for God to love the world and wash us from our sins in his blood.
Okay. Yeah, you know, I have studied the book of Revelation, I'm guessing probably more so than, I'm thinking 95 or maybe 99% of all Christians. And I'll be the first to admit, I will not teach on it with a lot of confidence because I've studied it from every expert point of view. And every theologian that has a particular take on it, like a preterist or a futurist or a historicist or idealist or however they see eschatology and the Book of Revelation, they all have, they're very very convincing. They're all so expert in their research and their evidence that to support their kind of philosophy on the book. So because of that, I have my opinions. I formulated opinions. I have conclusions about what I think, but I can't really teach it with a lot of confidence. But you're right. I don't usually go to it very often. There's a few verses here and there that we will use, but this one here regarding the blood, you know, that I did a thing with Jack Smack. We did about five or six gospel hymns and went through the lyrics of them recently. So, but those gospel hymns, those old hymns have some of the best gospel messages that you'll ever listen to. And there's one, you know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And there's also a famous sermons talking about the pleading the blood. In other words, when Jesus said, there will come a day when people come to me saying, Lord, Lord, didn't we do all of these wonderful works in your name? So Jesus is kind of indicating that there's going to be a judgment day where people come to him and plead their case. And the only plea that is valid is the blood. Your blood was shed for me. You paid for my sins. That's what I'm counting on. And so that's what's expressed here in this verse here. It says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness. So the first chapter of Revelation, you know, is an introduction. And so this is saying this message is coming from Jesus. He's a faithful witness. You can trust the word because this is what the message Jesus wants you to hear. And the first begotten of the dead. I'm going to read the Amplified and the footnotes on that particular word part. It's pretty interesting. And the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. So to me, I'd say the key to the verse there, that if I was going to pick some part that's most relevant to our conversation today, is it's that we are washed from our sins with the blood of Jesus. Before I go into the Amplified and the footnotes, do you want to respond to anything I said?
No. Go ahead.
Okay, so now this is, if you find fault with the Amplified in this, let me know. It says, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful and trustworthy witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who always loves us, and who has once for all freed us or washed us from our sins by his own blood, his sacrificial death. Any serious problems with that?
No, it's just really amplifying the sufficiency of what Christ did for us, and that it was once and for all. And we can't do anything to earn it. We can't wash ourselves from our sins by good deeds or water baptism or any other works or religious deeds that we do. It's strictly what Jesus Christ did for us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The footnotes, it says, Jesus was not the first person to be brought back to life, since he raised others from the dead, the most notable being Lazarus, in John chapter 11. But they had to experience death again. Jesus is the first to be restored to life with a glorified, immortal, everlasting body, never again to die. The word firstborn may point not only to Jesus' own resurrection, but also to his divine power to resurrect others. The firstborn, or preeminent, is given power over all things. I want to talk about this, the word preeminent and firstborn here, but let me get your thoughts on that that footnote.
Again, I don't see any issues with it. Just continuing to elaborate on Jesus and who he is. He's eternal. At the same time, he was God manifest in the flesh that was fully man, 100% God, 100% man, who experienced death on the cross, and that's the only way that our mortal flesh could overcome death through him, by his shedding of blood, human blood, which was the sacrificial payment, as I think that footnote said, or the Amplified version said. So, you can go ahead and talk about that further.
The first begotten of the dead is the phrase it's discussing, and they're making the point that Jesus' resurrection is totally different than the resurrection of Lazarus or what was the girl's name? Wasn't Lydia? It was
Jairus' daughter, I think.
Yeah. What was her name? I'll think of it in a minute. I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that there was a resurrection done by Elijah or Elisha. in the Old Testament, that they raised someone from the dead. So resurrections happened before Jesus' own bodily resurrection, but the distinction with them is that they are all raised to life, but then they end up dying again at some point. We don't have any record in the Bible of Lazarus dying. I guess we just all assume. I don't know if there's some historical record, extra biblical writing about it, but I guess we all think that, hey, Lazarus eventually died again. But Jesus, of course, his resurrection is a picture of our resurrection with a glorified body that will never die again. That's the distinction they're making here. But the other thing is this, when it says in the footnote, the firstborn, and in parentheses, it says preeminent, is given power over all things. That's why someone like the Jehovah's Witnesses, they take a verse when it says Jesus is the firstborn of creation, or over creation. I can't remember how it's phrased or where it is exactly, but they take that verse to show that Jesus is a creature. He's not eternal God Almighty, but he was created. He was the firstborn, or the first one that God created. And so this understanding the firstborn being, meaning it's preeminent, not necessarily order, is not referencing that he's the first one that's born. Is firstborn is like Isaac. Well, he wasn't the firstborn. That was gosh, who was his? Who was Hagar's son again? I forgot now.
Ishmael.
Yeah, Ishmael. Ishmael was the firstborn, but it was not the intended firstborn. God planned Sarah and to be the mother. But let's go to Jacob. Isaac had Jacob and Esau, and they were twins. Esau was the firstborn. So he was the one that was supposed to have this preeminent position, but he sold his inheritance, or his, what's the word? It wasn't inheritance, it was something else. He sold his birthright to his brother for a bowl of stew or something. And then he and Sarah, they scammed Isaac, thinking to trick him to think. That's why Jacob literally translates to trickster or deceiver. You know, isn't it funny how the names of these people, when you understand the meaning of the name, actually defines their character too. They deceived Isaac into thinking that Jacob was really Esau. So he got a blessing because his father was blind or half blind, and he felt his arm, and they put this fake thing on his arm to make him think he had a hairy arm. And so all that was very deceptive, but he ended up getting the blessing that should have gone to Esau. Now, why would it go to Esau? It's just because when you're the firstborn at that time, and that time and place, and those people, if you're the firstborn, or male at least, you had the preeminence. You were designated as the most important, and you'd be the leader, and everybody would have to answer to you, and you get the lion's share of the inheritance. So there was a lot of value in being firstborn, but it really referenced you had preeminence. You had the power over the others. And so that's when it talks about Jesus being the firstborn of creation. It's not that God created him, he's the first creature. It's that he has preeminence. His position is preeminent over all things. That's the answer to that Jehovah's Witness, belief. Okay.
Yeah, I agree.
All right. Let me see how much time. 49. We got 11 minutes. We got time for another verse, right? Anything on that before we move on? Anything else you want to say about that?
Yeah, I think that was great.
Okay, so we got Titus 3, verse 7. Titus 3, verse 7. that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Okay, brother?
This is a continuation of Titus 3, where it begins in verse 4, but after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. And we've already gone through that verse in earlier videos, so this is just a continuation of that. And it's not by our work of righteousness, then what is it by? Well, it tells us by God's mercy he saves us. We're justified by his grace. We don't justify ourselves by our actions. We're justified by his grace through faith. And that by receiving God's grace and his mercy and his love through the person of Jesus Christ and putting our faith in what he did for us, then we become heirs. And like I said before, joint heirs with Christ, where we can call the Heavenly Father, Abba Father, because we have that hope, that lively hope of eternal life. Hope in the sense of we have that trust, we have that assurance that is reserved in heaven for us, just like we saw earlier in the previous verses. And just finally, eternal life is used so many times in the Bible speaking about salvation, and it's used synonymously with everlasting life. Yet some people who, if they read any other book besides the Bible and saw that word eternal or saw a word everlasting, they would automatically think that author means forever, that whatever that book is describing is talking about something that's lasting forever. But yet, when we get to the Bible and we see this over and over and over again, suddenly those who have a hard heart and put a trust in themselves, thinking they're part of salvation, that you can lose your salvation, suddenly the word eternal doesn't mean eternal to them. The word everlasting doesn't mean everlasting to them. It's temporal to them, and they think that they can lose it because they think that they keep themselves saved by their actions. But as we saw in 1 Peter 1, we're kept by the power of God. Not by what we do, it's by what he did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Here we have the word justified. And we talked last time about clarifying kind of the differences between justified, What were the choices, the things, the words are justified? Salvation. Oh, yeah. The reason I'm forgetting is it's ION on the end. Justification. What's the difference between justification, salvation, and what was the other one? Right, starts with R.
Redemption.
What's that?
I think it was redemption.
Yeah, redemption. Redemption. And then that was Rob. Asked us to talk about that, and we did. And he also wanted us to talk about the word sanctification, but he made a comment thanking us for taking the time, and he appreciated our thoughts on that. He draws a little more distinctions than we did on this, but justified, they all basically, you can, the conclusion is that if you're justified and sanctified justification, sanctification, salvation, and gosh, what's the one with redemption? And if you're redeemed, all of those, the conclusion about it really, even though we talked about the subtle differences last time, really the most important thing is that we can be confident that because of those things, we're going to go to heaven. We're assured we're going to go to heaven. That's really, to me, the most important thing related to all those words that they all have in common. Now, sanctify or sanctification, we talked about that in a previous video, and that is means set apart as holy. So it's like when you put your faith in Jesus, God says, okay, Jason now is my child and he's holy. I don't see any sin on him. I just see Jesus and perfection. So I'm setting him apart. He's in this select group of people that are I'm recognizing as being holy. So sanctified, and it's immediate when you believe, and it's permanent. We don't, I think you agree with me that we don't think of sanctification as a process over a lifetime. That is more in terms of just, I would define that as spiritual growth and maturity, rather than sanctification. Sanctification just happens just like salvation happens in an instant. But in this case, it says that we're being justified by his grace only because God is gracious. So that's very much the same point that Paul's made many other places. We should be made heirs according to the hope, should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Before I read this in the Amplified, because I looked at the Amplified while you were talking, and I want to read that, but anything about what I said there that you want to talk about? Okay, so you look at the KJV and compare this and see if you find any problems with it. It says, so that we would be justified, that is, made free of the guilt of sin, by his, that is, compassionate, undeserved grace, and that we would be, that is, acknowledged as acceptable to him and made heirs of eternal life, that is, actually experiencing it, according to our hope, and that is his guarantee. Your thoughts on that?
I think that's fine. They're really emphasizing that we can be assured and know now, and that hope, that trust that we have in eternal life, we can use that lively hope, that active hope of eternal life to go on and use it to our advantage to lead a better Christian life and to tell others and be confident and assured so that we become a better disciple of Christ rather than somebody that doesn't have that lively hope and has doubt in their mind. God doesn't want believers to have doubt in their minds about their security and them being a child of God. He wants us to know that we have eternal life. As it says in 1 John 5:13, because he knows that confidence of knowing that will help us to grow spiritually and then go on and tell the good news to other people so that we're profitable to others.
Mm-hmm. Now, when I'm reading this, people are they're listening to me, but they don't have the benefit of seeing the text that I'm reading in the Amplified. So when I say that is, I'm that's because there's a parenthesis and that's an insertion. So it says, like from the end, it says according to our hope, and then in parentheses, his guarantee. So I read it as according to our hope, that is his guarantee. So that's an insertion. That's their interpretation on the word hope, what it means. And so I like the fact that they emphasize twice now. When we look at the word hope, they are saying it's a guarantee. Mm-hmm. All right. Any thoughts on that more before you go to your other point you're holding for us?
Well, I think it goes hand in hand with it. Talking about being profitable to others and leading the Christian life by having that lively hope, being assured of that, having confidence in God's promise. And that leads me to Titus 3:8. And, this is just showing the difference between salvation and receiving the free gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ and what he did. And then going unto good works as a believer in Christ, after receiving that free gift, which is a one-time event, a spiritual rebirth, it's your spiritual birthday, then going on to be a disciple and maturing and growing and being profitable to others and sharing the gospel with others, which is a lifelong process of discipleship. And Titus 3 verses 4 through 8 do a great job of showing this, how one goes from hearing the word of God, receiving the gospel message, and then how that how we should go on such a good works after that. So, in verse 5, for instance, it says, it's not by works of righteousness we have done, but according to his mercy that he saved us. And then verse 7, we're justified by his grace, and made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Then verse 8 says, this is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. Why? These things are good and profitable unto men. So after we believe in Jesus Christ, we are saved by God's mercy, by his grace, through our faith. Then Paul is telling Titus and us that once we do that, then take that next step. Be careful to maintain those good works so that we're good and profitable unto men. And this reminds me of Ephesians 2:8-10. You know, for by grace are you saved through faith, and not yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But then it goes on to verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. And if we want to finish the process, there's another passage that comes to mind, 2 Timothy 3, verses 15 through 17, which says, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, and this is Paul writing to Timothy, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. So there's your salvation verse right there. But then goes on, all scriptures given by inspiration of God, profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. And then verse 17, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. So in those three examples, Titus 3, Ephesians 2, 2 Timothy 3, we see how to receive salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ, by God's grace through faith, Jesus Christ, and that it's not of our righteousness, it's not of our work, not of our efforts, but then we go on unto good works. But it doesn't say that we automatically do good works. In any of those verses, it doesn't say that you automatically, if you are a believer, you will have a changed life 100% guaranteed. Absolutely not. And that's why verse 8 is written after verse 7 in Titus 3. That's why Ephesians 2:10 is written after verses 8 and 9. That's why the last verse of 2 Timothy 3 is written. Because it says that we need to be careful to maintain good works to show that we're saying no, to be good and profitable unto men. And Ephesians 2:10, that this doesn't say that God has ordained that we will walk in them, talking about good works. No, he said we should walk in them. And then in 2 Timothy 3, that the man of God may be made perfect, not being perfect without sin and having sinless perfection, because nobody will ever achieve that in this mortal flesh, either before you're saved or after. But that being perfect, meaning mature, truly burning unto all good works. So we have the Holy Spirit. We have to seal a promise as a believer so that we should use God's grace and the Holy Spirit of promise that he gives us. We're furnished unto all good works. But that we still have that choice to do that. If you don't mature and if you don't read the Bible and do all these things, you aren't going to be that person, that believer that God wants you to be. He's really furnished you unto all good works, but you got to go out and do the work. But just because you do or don't do the good work doesn't prove that you are or are not saved. That's strictly through Jesus Christ. So if you think that you're showing your faith by your actions and how obedient you are, you're not looking at the cross. When Jesus said it is finished, you're looking at yourself and what you're doing and to give you the trust in your work. So I just wanted to make that distinction between salvation and discipleship, because worship salvationists will study the two, and depending on how much they twist it, you know, it can get to the point, as often does, where they make works part of salvation. And that is what these false prophets do. They come in unawares and privily get into congregations and will say it's by grace through faith in Christ alone. But then over time, they'll start mixing in some Calvinist doctrine, or they'll start mixing in some worship salvation doctrine and get people of faith confused. Wait, I thought it was my faith and what Jesus did, but now I have to do these works to show that I'm saved, and it's confusing. And the reason it's confusing is because it's not coming from the right spirit. It's coming from another spirit. It's not coming from the Holy Spirit. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. So we should rest in God's promise and the peace that comes with understanding the true gospel and not missing all these works and efforts that these false prophets will try to tell you that proves you're saved. Don't listen to them.
Well, you know, when you begin your talk there, I had a list of thoughts I wanted to state, but I'm kind of speechless. There's nothing else I can say. Yeah, I've never heard anybody express it any better, so let me just leave it at that. Just well said, and I hope everybody, if they're unclear on this, that you've straightened it out for them, and that they maybe should listen to your words there over and over again to make sure it sinks in. All right, brother, our time has passed. We're 7 minutes over an hour now, so there's just enough time here to do your summary. Can you sum up the study?
Yeah, I love these verses. You know, we only got the three again. Got a little sidetracked in discussing the first one in 1 Peter 1:3-5. But again, 1 Peter 1 is a great chapter beginning to speak about God's abundant mercy that He has. None of our good deeds were kept by the power of God, and that He has an incorruptible, that He has, you know, it's incorruptible and reserved in heaven for us. And we see that at the end of 1 Peter, this continuing thought process about the incorruptibility that comes about through trust in the Word of God. And then Revelation 1:5 talks about being washed in Jesus' blood, what He did for us, and that is how we achieve the remission of sin, is through the blood of Jesus, what He did for us. And then Titus 3, being justified by God's grace. You know, it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us. It's His mercy, it's His grace, it's His love. It's not our grace, mercy, or love. We can't save ourselves. We have to depend on Him and what He did for us. And then, you know, just finishing up, again, this whole study is to show that it's by faith alone. So we really want to hammer this point home, but at the same time, we need to understand that we should go on unto good works and mature as a Christian, to be a good disciple, a good witness, be profitable to others, share the gospel of others, but that's never part of the gospel. And so the end of our discussion, I really wanted to make that point clear with those three passages that we discussed.
Mm-hmm. All right, brother, thank you. And I really enjoyed this talk, as usual. That's kind of redundant. Every conversation I have, I don't know, it seems like it's more fun than the last one. If I have any more fun, it might explode.
I agree. These have been great.
Yeah. So I look forward to next time. And to the viewers, if you have never done this, I hope right now you will just completely put your faith in Jesus and receive the free gift of salvation. Reject the idea that somehow you get to go to heaven if you're just a good enough person. The Bible tells us it's impossible to earn our salvation. That's why we need Jesus to give it to us as a gift. Yeah, he did die for all of our sins. So sin is not an issue anymore between you and God. He raised himself from the dead to prove that that's a sign he promised, that he said he would prove his claims. He is God. He is the Savior. He does have power over life and death. And he promises you, he guarantees you that he will raise you to life everlasting. And you get to have a beautiful, wonderful, glorified body that will never get sick or old or die again and have eternal life in heaven. That's all guaranteed to you if you just put your faith in Jesus completely. I hope you do it now. Bless you in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus.